Right. Thank you very much for the invitation. It's a real pleasure to be back in Berkeley. So I'm going to present some joint work with Charles Bordenave and Pietro Caputo, and it will be very much related to Yuval's talk yesterday. So here is the outline of the talk. I would like first to spend a few minutes on the generalities about the cutoff phenomenon for Markov chains, right? So just recall the definition and give you a few examples. Then I'll switch to the class of Markov chains that will be of interest for the rest of the talk, which is a random walk on directed graphs. So I will give you a few motivations for studying this kind of object, both theoretical and applied motivations. And finally, I'll give you a few results that we had in that direction. All right. So Markov chain mixing, let's take a very simple setting. Suppose that you have a finite state space Markov chain, right, with an irreducible and aperiodic transition matrix. So you know that there is a unique stationary distribution, and you know also that you have convergence, right, just meaning entry-wise convergence of the matrix P power T. Right. Now, the crucial question in practical application is really how fast does this convergence occur, and how fast in terms of the size of your state space. Right. So if you want to quantify this, you need to agree on a way to measure the distance between probability distributions. And as we have seen in Yuval's talk, there are several ways of doing that. So in this talk, I will just focus on the L1 distance, so the total variation distance between two probability measures. Also, you have, as we have seen in Eyal's talk, you have an important role is played by the initial condition that you put. Here, I will just look at the worst case condition, so maximum over all possible initial states, but I'll comment on that later. All right, so this function is a very nice thing. It's between 0 and 1 always. It's always decreasing in t, so typically something like that, between 0 and 1. And the mixing time of your chain is just you fix a precision epsilon, say 1/4, and then you just wait, you look at the time it takes before your distance falls below this threshold, right? So that will be the mixing time of the chain. Okay, so let me give you an example where this can be completely determined, an historical example, actually, so card shuffling. So suppose that you have a deck of n cards, and the question is how long does it take before how many times should you iterate your shuffling procedure in order to mix the deck properly? So to model this as a Markov chain, the state space is pretty obvious. You just take the set of all possible orderings of the n cards. For the dynamics, you have many options, actually, to model the card shuffling. Here, I will take something which is not really realistic, but which is simpler to analyze. It's the so-called top-to-random shuffle. So how it works, you just, at each step, you take the first card of your deck, and you insert it back at a random position inside the deck, right? And you keep iterating that, and the question is how long before you reach the, how long should you repeat this procedure before you reach the stationary distribution, which is of course the uniform distribution here. And this question was answered by David Aldous and Percy Diaconis in the 80s, and the answer is n log n, and n log n in a very strong sense. Namely, that it does not depend at all on the precision that you want to achieve. Right? So for any fixed epsilon, as n tends to infinity, the times it takes to mix is n log n independently of epsilon. So what it means on this picture is that the distance to equilibrium is not at all like that. It's something that stays at 1 for a very long time and then suddenly drop to 0 in a sharp a very narrow window around this mixing time, right? So again, just to make sure that this is clear, if you shuffle your deck just 0.99 n log n times, then you basically did nothing, right? The total variation distance is essentially the one you started with. And if you do it just a little bit further, then the deck is completely mixed. It's useless to continue mixing. So that's something that you should really know in practice if you you want to approximate this uniform distribution. Okay, so you can go one step further when you see that. So what it says is that somehow everything happens around this n log n, and you would like to zoom in inside this window and see how exactly the transition from 1 to 0 occurs. Right? So in that case, I guess it was already present in the original result by Eldus and Diaconis that the correct order, the scale at which you should zoom is order n, so much smaller than n log n. Right. And if you zoom in inside this window, right, so meaning looking at the total variation distance at times that are n log n plus lambda times n, where lambda can be negative or positive, it's something that really parametrizes where you are inside this critical window, then the distance converges to some non-trivial constant between 0 and 1, which depends on lambda. So this function phi, this decreasing function phi, gives you exactly the shape of this this abrupt decay from 1 to 0. It was given explicitly in this Diaconis field Pittman paper. It's an infinite sum that is not easy to write down, so I will not do it here, but it's an explicit function. So that's the kind of results that I will be interested in during the rest of the talk. Are there any questions on that? Okay, so this was just the simple example to understand things, but actually this phenomenon is very general. Right? It has been observed in many situations, actually very different situations. So card shuffling is one of them, and you can look at more sophisticated procedures than the one I just described, and still the cutoff phenomenon occurs. Another important class of chains for which cutoff is very well understood is birth and death chains, where you have a simple criterion to determine whether there is cutoff or not based on the probabilities that you see. Another class is random walks on finite groups, so it's more general than just card shuffling, which is the permutation group. Here also the situation starts to be well understood. Still there are many open questions in that case. Glauber dynamics, as you have seen in a few talks now, it's something that starts to be understood. Still, there are many things that remain to be understood. But recently, in particular, the works of Alan and Eyal made tremendous progress in that direction. And finally, the class of Markov chains that I will be interested in, it's more closely related to the class I will study later, is random walks on sparse graphs. So as Yuval explained, the bonded degree case is slightly more difficult and more interesting also. And recently, there have been a lot of studies on that case. So let me just remind a bit the references that Yuval gave you yesterday. So I guess the groundbreaking paper in that field was the paper by Alan and Eyal in 2010 on random regular graphs. Right? So as we all know, those random graphs have remarkable mixing properties, right? From a spectral point of view, but also from an expansion point of view. And this should imply that the mixing of the random walk is efficient on those graphs, but this took a long time to actually pinpoint the precise mixing time on those graphs, and so this was done by Alan and Eyal, and they also determined the precise window here and the limiting shape of inside the window. So again, it's a very nice paper with I guess it's really easy to read, but you get a lot of ideas to tackle more sophisticated graph examples, and that's what was done later. So as Yuval explained, this is actually a much more general phenomenon. Right? Not only random regular graphs do satisfy this cutoff, but actually any Ramanujan graph or almost Ramanujan graph does satisfy the same cutoff with the same window and profile. Another class of sparse graphs where cutoff is well understood now is the class of trees, right? So result by people in the audience here. tells you precisely when there is cutoff and where there is no cutoff without having to do any computation on when you study random walk on trees. And finally, models of graphs where you can play a bit more with the degrees in the graphs have been analyzed. So as Yuval explained yesterday, there is one hard model, which is really the simple random walk, which was studied in this first paper. And the second one just focuses on the easy case, which is the non-backtracking one. All right, so that's it for the references. The thing that I just wanted to say is that even though it looks like a lot of progress has been done, there are still many questions in this area, right? I guess it's fair to say that the phenomenon is still far from being completely understood, in the sense that there is no simple criterion that would allow you to determine whether there is or there is no cutoff without having to do a precise computation, right? And another aspect in which the cutoff is not really understood is that if you look at this list of examples, I guess it's pretty clear that there are only very few results outside the reversible world. And this was the starting point of the work that we did, right? We wanted to study a class of natural class of Markov chains which are non-reversible and for which we can still say something about the cutoff phenomenon. All right. So this brings me to my second part, right? Random walks on directed graphs. So what do I mean by that? Just now have orientations on the edges. Your state space is just the set of vertices of your graph. And at each step, you just choose one of the outgoing edges uniformly at random, you traverse it, and you move to the end point, right? So in this specific example, here is the transition matrix just to be definite. Right. So the graph here is strongly connected, meaning that the matrix P is irreducible. And so you have a unique invariant distribution. And you can start asking questions like, how long does it take for the walk to mix? But also, maybe even more importantly, what does the stationary distribution pi actually looks like? So that's an important point. I would like to insist a bit on that. In the non-directed case, right? So no orientations on the edges, the invariant measure is somehow trivial. It's just the degree, right, up to proportionality. So you have to divide by twice the number of edges. And if you move to an undirected setting, so now you have orientation on the edges, then this completely collapses. It's not true anymore that this measure is reversible, and actually there is no exact formula for pi. There is nothing explicit that you can say about it. Right. So that's one of the main difficulties behind this class of Markov chains. Right. Even worse than that, if you think of your graph as being very large, and if you want to understand pi, it's a priori an arbitrarily complicated function of the whole graph. Right? You can build specific examples where you change just a tiny thing here, very very far away from your vertex, and it completely changes the measure assigned to the vertex x. So it's a highly non-local thing, and it makes it quite hard to understand.
What are those distributions you wrote down here?
Which distribution?
What set of distributions here?
So those are just the transition probabilities, right? So from state one, with probability.
Example, so.
Yes, it's just the transition matrix corresponding to that graph, right? Was just to make things definite. But, okay, so apart from the fact that the measure pi is not known, there is another difficulty, which is that the chain is not reversible. And this means that you don't have the nice spectral tools that you would have when P is self-adjoint. You cannot rely on that, and that's one of the additional difficulties with this kind of model. Okay, so that explains at least from a theoretical point of view why it's interesting to look at those chains. But I would like to make also the point that it's also very natural from an applied viewpoint. Right? If you think of large social networks or real world networks like the internet graph, there it really matters to understand this equilibrium distribution pie for the following reason. It's actually at the heart of Google PageRank algorithm, right? If you have a huge network and you want to assign some measure of importance to the vertices based on the connection that they receive, it's pretty clear that you would like to assign an important mass to a vertex if it receives a lot of connections from the outside, right? But of course, it's not the same if those guys here have themselves are very important, or if they are not important. So you should iterate this. And finally, it's not the same if an important guy points to you and only to you, or if it also points to many other nodes. Right. So if you try to write down the equation for what I just said, what you get is precisely this stationary equation. Right. So. So in effect, what you want to do when you try to rank pages on the internet graph is really compute this invariant distribution for the random walk on this graph. And that's why Google keeps sending robots on the internet performing those random walks. All right. So of course, this kind of model is very hard to study. There is not really any realistic, tractable model that would be close to that kind of graph. So we have to take something much simpler. And the choice that we made was this directed configuration model. So in a directed configuration model, it's a way to generate a random graph in which you can freely specify the degrees that you would like the graph to have. Right. So suppose that you give yourself a set of n vertices, and for each vertex, you specify the number of edges that should come to this vertex and the number of edges that should go out of the vertex. Right, so you have those numbers, and if you want to construct a graph with those constraints, you really need that the sum of the degrees, of course, match. Right. That's an obvious condition if you want. And I will call this number M for the rest of the talk. Now, as soon as you have this constraint, you can actually build a graph, provided you allow loops and multiple edges, and that's what I will do. So here is the simple algorithm to generate a random graph with those constraints. Right? You just assign to each vertex the correct number of heads and the correct number of tails that it should have based on the parameters that you have decided. And then you just randomly connect heads to tails, right? by picking a uniform bijection among the factorial M possibilities. That's the directed configuration model. You can think of it also as the putting a uniform distribution on all the possible graphs that have the correct degree constraints. This is true as long as you condition the graph that you obtain not to have any loops or multiple edges. So that's one way of thinking about it. Any question on the model itself?
Condition that the graph is simple?
I will not, but I will prove the result that I will mention will be valid for this model, but as soon as they are valid with probability tending to 1 for this model, it implies that they are also valid when you condition on CPC. Okay, so let me show you a few pictures before I state the result. So to simulate things, I need to specify a choice of parameters. So I took arbitrarily just 3,000 vertices, and I divided them into three classes, right? So there is 1,000 vertices which have out and in degree 3 and 2, and so on, right? And then you can plot the distance to equilibrium a long time, and the picture that you get is this in this example. So there are two nice features in this picture. The first one is that even though the graph is quite large, right, 3,000 vertices, it still takes less than 10 iterations before you forget completely where you started. So that's one important point. And of course, we'd like to understand how this 10 relates to the 3,000 and also to the degrees. So how does this scale as n tends to infinity? Right?
Does this make the equilibrium distribution easy to calculate if you have this? If you break them up into blocks, I guess. You've got an easy.
No. What I use is brute force. I just ask Maple to iterate the powers of my matrix, and that's how I got it. So I didn't try to optimize the.
Okay. And if you replace 1,000 by 100,000, it gets much harder. I mean,
sure.
you're not saving anything by.
Sure.
No. I will show you. I will mention something at the end of the talk towards that. Okay, the second interesting thing is that if you look at the five or six first steps, they are actually useless from the point of view of total variation distance, right? You stay at one. So it seems to be, again, an instance of the cutoff phenomenon. And this is something that we wanted to make rigorous. Okay. So I didn't tell you about the equilibrium measure. So I would like to understand a bit what those number pi of x look like, at least in this example. So let me show you a simulation. So forget about the graph structure. Just look at the masses, the equilibrium masses pi of x. So you have n such numbers. The total sum should be 1. So if you want to see something, I need to rescale everything by multiplying by n. Right. And then here is the histogram of the values that you get. Right. So just to make things definite, if pi were the uniform distribution, I would just have a Dirac mass at 1 here. Right. And that's what you get. So it's something that is non-trivial. There seems to be a bimodal density here. It seems to be very regular, but my bimodal. And there are many questions to ask. First of all, is it really continuous in the limit? And also, what can you say about those tails, both the lower and upper tails? That's questions that are of interest in practice. Right? So that's something we wanted to understand also. And last picture that I wanted to show, even though I will not use it in the rest of the talk, it's just interesting to plot the eigenvalues of the transition matrix, and that's what you get. So something a nice picture, I think. And there is ongoing work on making this picture rigorous. But so you don't see it, but there is always, of course, an eigenvalue at 1 for any Markov chain. Right? The rest of it is in the complex plane because the matrix is not self-adjoint. And all the other eigenvalues seems to be far away from 1, right? All inside this disk, which I represented in blue. And we have conjectural formulas for the radius of this disk. I will tell you a bit more about that later. But just to tell you that the matrix seems to have something interesting in its eigenstructure. Right. So if we were in a reversible world, a picture like that would immediately imply that the mixing is fast, right? But here, in the non-Hermitian case, it's not clear how to use this information to say something about the speed of convergence. All right. So let me finally move to the main results. So the cutoff phenomenon is something that is asymptotic in N. So remember that here I have degree specification. So I need to have actually degree specification for each N. So you should really think, I will not explicitly write it, but you should really think of this as indexed by n. For each n, I have a sequence of n in degrees, a sequence of n out degrees, and I'm looking at the asymptotics as n tends to infinity. Right? So I'm not assuming any convergence for those numbers. The only thing I'm assuming, it's a strong assumption though, is that all those numbers are bounded uniformly in n. Right? So I'm just looking at directed graphs that have, say, 1,000 neighbors for each vertex at most. Right? Also, there is a bound on the other direction, right? The degree should be at least 2, right? And this is to ensure that your graph is strongly connected with high probability. Otherwise, you get into troubles for defining your measure pi, and so we wanted to avoid that. Right? The assumption on delta is really strong, but we, I think, without too much work, you could relax it a bit. Right? Allowing delta to grow moderately with n would not be a problem. What would be interesting is to see what happens when delta grows more quickly with n. Right? So you have certain vertices that have a lot of connections, and this should affect the way the random walk mixes. And this would be more realistic for if you think of the internet graph, for example, where you have certain websites that are extremely well connected compared to others. Okay. So, a priori, the mixing time of a random walk on such a graph should depend on many things. Should depend on the randomness of the graph itself, right? So our first surprise was that it's actually not the case. Most graphs with degrees given by what you specify, they actually have the same mixing time, right? So that's the first result. And now if this mixing time does not depend at all on the randomness, it just depends on the degrees, it could still be something very complicated in terms of the degrees. It's actually not the case. Everything is determined just by a very simple statistics, which is this number mu, which implicitly depends on n, right? So what is mu? Mu is obtained by the following experiment. You just pick an edge uniformly at random in your graph, and you look at the number of successors of that edge, right? And you make an average of the logarithm of this quantity across the graph, right? So somehow the average logarithmic branching number of your graph, something like that. Right. So because of our assumptions on the degrees, this is something which is bounded away from zero and infinity. Right. So mu is really, it depends on n, right? But it's really something that is of order one. Okay, and so the first result is as follows. You have cut off runtime log n divided by this constant mu. And the precise result is this, that if you look at the distance in total variation, to the distance to equilibrium just before log n divided by mu, it's basically 1. And if you look just after that, it's basically 0. Right? Again, the graph itself is random, so the transition matrix is random. So the distance in total variation is a random variable. And the convergence here is in probability. What it really means is that for most graphs with degree sequences given by what you decided, the mixing time is log n divided by mu. Okay, so now when you see that, you really want, as before, to look to zoom in around lambda equals 1 and see what happens there, right, inside the critical window. And for this, it turns out that, again, it does not really depend on the precise realization of your graph. It just depends on the degrees that you have chosen, and it depends on them in a very simple way. So it's just the variance associated to this average branching number, logarithmic branching number. So again, this parameter is something which is bounded away from infinity by our assumptions on the degree. However, it could tend to zero, right? And so I will have to assume something about that. But so here is the precise result. Precise result is that the correct window in which you need to zoom in to see something non-trivial is square root of log n times this sigma. Right? Again, keep in mind that sigma could tend to zero, so Wn could be something smaller than log n, actually. But we need sigma not to tend to zero too quickly, so we'll just assume that the window is still larger than log n. Right. So think of sigma as being fixed, bounded away from zero if you wish, but that's slightly weaker. Now in this regime, the thing that you get is that the total variation distance to equilibrium inside the window, so for fixed lambda, which could be negative or positive, right, you are traversing the window, then the distance to equilibrium converges again to something which is non-trivial between zero and one. This thing is deterministic, meaning that it does not depend on the randomness of your graph. Right. So it should be a deterministic function from 1 to 0. And the nice thing is that it does not depend at all on the degrees, the choice of degrees. It's a function which is universal. It's actually the simplest possible function that you could think of that is decreasing from 1 to 0, for a probabilist at least. That's the Gaussian tail. Right. Okay. So it's the... It's a function that pops up in many examples of where the cutoff phenomenon has been proved. So there is some kind of universality in that in this shape inside the cutoff window. Okay, so I did not. I told you at the beginning that I would come back to the choice of the initial condition. So let me briefly mention that. So as you have seen in Eyal talks yesterday, things can change very much if you look at not at the worst possible initial condition, but at something different than that, a typical vertex or other possibilities. In many cases, it can really improve the time that it takes for the work to mix. Right? We can ask this question here. And the answer is that it actually does not impact at all the results. So all the things that I just said remain the same. If instead of taking the worst case scenario, you take the best case scenario, right? Best possible vertex. So not only it does not affect the mixing time, the first order of the mixing time, but also the window and the limiting shape is not affected at all by the choice of your vertex. But you can go a bit further and ask whether it will, you can accelerate the convergence if you start from something a bit more spread out than just a Dirac mass at a vertex, right? And we took something which is quite spread out. Actually, it's the uniform distribution, but not on the vertices, right? Uniform distribution on the edges. So from the point of view of vertices, you have the mass that you receive is proportional to the in degree, right? But think of it as the uniform distribution. It's just more convenient to work with that. And if you start from this, you should be much closer to equilibrium. So you should really be in the regime where what you feel is a relaxation time rather than a mixing time, right? And as you have seen in the pictures, the eigenvalue plot that I showed, the spectral gap seems to be bounded away from zero. So if the chain was reversible, then you could infer that this relaxation time should be constant. So at least that's a good heuristic to expect a constant time convergence when you start from this uniform distribution. And that's actually what we proved. So the distance to equilibrium after t iterations from the uniform distribution is something that decreases exponentially in t, and this exponential rate is uniform in n. Right. So basically, after 10 or 20 iterations, you are completely mixed independently of the size of the graph. Right. So that's actually one way to accelerate the computation of the equilibrium law. Right? Rather than starting from a specific vertex, you start from the uniform and then you get a constant time convergence. Okay, and this constant rho, we believe that it's the correct constant to put here. And this is, again, a simple statistics of the degrees. And that's actually the radius of the circle that I plotted for the eigenvalues of my matrix P. So that's why we think that this rho should be really the spectral radius of the matrix.
Excuse me.
Yeah?
Could you remind us that the minimum out degree is 2 or 1?
2. It's 2, yeah.
If it's 1, then you will have a...
Yes, definitely, definitely, yeah. Yeah. Okay, so the important implication of that for us was that, right, remember, the equilibrium distribution, we don't know anything about it, and that's part of what makes this slightly difficult to analyze. And as I told you, a priori, this pi of x could depend on, in a complicated way, on everything in the network, even far away. But this thing here tells you that actually it's not the case, right? It tells you that pi of x is approximately nu times pt of x for t, again, being 10 or something that does not depend on n, right? And the nice thing is that this object here, you can compute it by just looking around x, by just looking at a ball of radius t, right? Fixed radius independently of n. So finally, even though it's not the case in general for general directed graphs, in those graphs with high probability, your equilibrium mass is something that is a function that is local, right? That is completely determined by a small ball of fixed radius around your vertex x. Right. Yes.
The simulation you had is bimodal
picture. Yes. I will come to that in the next slide. So that was very good news for us because the global structure of the graph is something that is hard to understand, but the local structure in a ball of fixed radius is something that is really simple in this sparse regime, right? The graph looks really like a Galton-Watson tree, a simple Galton-Watson tree. And so this gives you a way to understand this measure pi in a very simple way. All right, so let me just give you the intuition for that. And if your graph is really a Galton-Watson tree, and you want to understand this the measure at the root of your tree, then if you write down the equation for what it should be, depending on the equilibrium measure at the children of the root, this should be just the sum over all children, pi of y, and you divide by the out degree of y. Right. So that's just the stationary equation. But now, if you know that pi is a local function, it should be just something that depends on the backward ball of small radius around each child. In particular, those pi's should be completely independent from one child to the other. Right? So those random variables here should be IID, and they should be IID copies of pi of x. So this gives you a cavity recursion, a recursive distributional equation, which you can actually solve to say things about pi of x. And that's what we did. So here the problem is to understand this collection of stationary masses, and the approximation that I will give to you turns out to be in this Wasserstein metric. Right? And the result is as follows. So you have this complicated empirical distribution of stationary masses in your graphs. So this is a random object that is a priori extremely complicated. And we prove that it's very close to a simple deterministic measure L. And L is obtained by exactly solving this equation on your Galton-Watson tree. Right? So this is something that you can really simulate and get a handle on. Right? But more importantly, this recursive distributional equation turns out to be a special case of a more general class of recursive distributional equations that have been studied in the literature. They appear in the context of Mandelbrot cascades and things like that. And so we could just extract, once we had this result, we could just extract the results that have been proved for this kind of equation to get information about this limiting distribution L. And in particular, one of those results is that there is always a density with respect to Lebesgue's measure. So that's something that we get for free here. And also, there are informations about the tails, the right and left tails, that you can extract easily from this. And again, this has been done, so we did not need to do it again. All right. So it's time to conclude, so let me just stop here and thank you for your attention.
So the model
here is very far away from something realistic, right? In many aspects. The first one is that the degrees here are completely bounded. Again, in a real world network, they should be, even though the average degree is bounded, there should be nodes that have a high connectivity and others which have not. So we believe that this connectivity will be so large, actually the degrees should be heavy tailed. And this should affect really the behavior of the walk. So I'm not sure that this tells anything about the real internet graph. So that's the first thing. The second thing is that even though you can play with the degree distributions, you have models, tractable models, where the degrees are heavy tails, random graphs which have heavy tail degrees. Still, there is a big difference, which is that in all those sparse models, you have a locally tree-like structure, which plays a deep role in the proof, actually. And this is not at all true in the internet, right? If you look at the internet, you have local correlations that are extremely important, right? If your personal web page probably points out to colleagues that also points out one to another, and so you have this small cycle structure that... yes. And this should affect definitely the picture. So I'm not claiming that this tells anything realistic about the graph, but we have to start somewhere, and that's...
Separating out those which have very high out degree from those which have very high in degree, and you call them constant authority. And one of those things he did is sort of think of it as a form of
tripartite configuration. Do you think of any generalizations of things that can be separated into that subregion where you can handle some high degree cases?
That sounds very interesting.
That was not a proof.
No, but I've not looked at that, but it must be something interesting to look at, right, when you have,
It's actually even more interesting because, in some sense, his model was a kind of a better model for the web, but it was more difficult to compute than PageRank. So PageRank won not because it's a better measure, but it was easier to compute.
Okay.
A better way to compute the Hubs and Authority structure, that will be very, very interesting.
Okay, so I'll definitely look at that.
The I, your distribution of eigenvalues in the circle looks kind of uniform. Is that what one would expect for some obvious reason?
No, so the thing I told you about was just the spectral radius for the Markov chain, but of course you can also ask for the bulk statistics of this thing. And we have conjectures for that. But it's really not easy to do if you think that even the simplest case of deregular directed graphs, there is a conjecture for what should be the limiting spectral distribution of those eigenvalues. But it's not proved yet. And it's really, again, the undirected version is trivial. The limit is the Keston-McKay distribution, and this is really easy to see. But as soon as you leave this Hermitian world, all the techniques collapse, and there is no... yet no rigorous results. But the conjecture is explicitly written somewhere, I can tell you, at least for the deregular case.
We thank the speaker.